Even though this live bootleg recording was made on August 29th, 1977, for over 30 years, I had no idea that the tapes even existed. I first became aware of them in late 2008. Shortly after, thankfully, they were sent to me. Then, on December 17th, I received the tapes, and it really helped to brighten that holiday season. Since the tapes were so old, I was afraid of listening to them. The last thing I wanted to do was to snap them in two. Instead, I sent the two cassette tapes to mastering guru Trevor Sadler. Trevor's a phenomenal mastering engineer who has worked with me since 2005. He then painstakingly transferred them into a digital format using three different tape decks to get the best fidelity possible. When I first heard a raw transfer of the entire performance on January 7th, 2009, I loved the energy, performance, and audience reaction. I was thrilled to hear all these songs. There were some that I had no other recordings of. There were others I barely remembered. There were even some that I completely forgot that I ever wrote. After I listened to the transfer for a while, I thought that it might be a good idea to consider releasing the concert. My only concern, though, was if the sound quality was good enough. A few weeks later, on January 20th, I wrote a post on my blog. In part, I wanted to get a sense of fan reaction. I was surprised that it turned out to be entirely favorable. I said in that post that I would decide whether to release the performance or not within around 30 days. While doing my weight training workouts, I listened to a ton of bootlegs and compared them to mine. Then, in mid to late February, I made my decision. I felt that the sound quality was certainly good enough for a proper release. I just needed to let everyone know up front that it was a bootleg quality recording. It's always a thrill to be as close to the action as possible, and this performance puts you right there. Hearing it now is just like being in that North Side uptown Chicago club with my band and audience. This concert dates back to my pioneering days in Chicago. That's when my band and I debuted at Club Beginnings in February 1976. That show has been credited as the birth of the Chicago punk, new wave, and indie scene. By the time this concert came around, we had already done a lot of things that were getting both local and national press. After the first studio recordings in August 1976, we did a two-month Chicago area club tour, and the local press took notice. On February 4th, 1977, we caused 6,000 people to riot when we opened for Sha Na Na at Chicago's Airy Crown Theater, and Billboard magazine wrote a story about the incident. In April of 1977, we were the first Chicago artist to play CBGB's in New York, and Variety magazine did a review. By the time of my 21st birthday concert, we already had an audience. Plus, we were being talked about quite a bit, especially because of the controversy that surrounded many of the shows. So here's some behind-the-scenes technical stuff that needed to get done to be able to get the tapes ready to roll. In mastering the original tapes, Trevor Sadler removed some of the surface noise, made the volume of the tracks consistent, and did some compression. He also adjusted the EQ to maximize the clarity and quality of the overall sound. My first cousin, Bobby Skafish, actually did two introductions that night. The first was for the show opener You Invited Me, and the other began the second set with Let's Play Doctor. Trevor and I just condensed Bobby's words into one single intro to kick off the album. The sequence of the original performance remained mostly intact for the release, except we changed the order a few times here and there. That was so the entire concert could fit into the physical format we were going to release it in. There were only three tracks that didn't make the final cut. They Give You Bad Feelings was omitted simply because the recording quality was not quite as good as it needed to be. Disgracing the Family Name was not included for two reasons. The recording quality was not up to par, and much of the complex vocal performance was not audible enough. She Lives for Love, which had its debut that night, was not released due to copyright issues. That was because at the end of the song, it overlapped and segued into a brief rendition of the Bobby Darin classic, Beyond the Sea. Even if I would have wanted to remix the tapes, which is unlikely, I couldn't. That's because I only had two cassette tapes that were copies. I didn't have the original masters. Beyond what we needed to do technically to get things ready, here are some points worth noting about this project. Both the mix and recording quality on the first track, You Invited Me, were a bit rough, but they started improving by track two. Along with She Lives for Love, I Need Something had its debut that night. On the original tapes I received, the encores we did weren't included. Honestly, I just don't remember what they were. Sink or Swim also faded out on the original tapes I received, just as it does on this release. That's why I named that track Sink or Swim Intro. Besides this entire concert being previously unreleased, it features 15 of my compositions that have never been released on any level before. That includes some of my favorites from that era, like I Need Something, 5 o'clock Face, Sunstroke, Start at the Start, and I Missed the Prom Last Night. There's also We'll See, the Chicago Cubs baseball game, Home Invader, Let's Play Doctor, Waterhead Chant, and Beefcake Touch. Some others on that list are Lifelong Friends, Toilet Train, One Size Fits All, Kissy Face, and Bachelor Pad. Finally, they are all experiencing their first release ever. After all this time, I am so grateful that they can now be heard. On July 20th, 1977, I went out to one of the Chicago area rock clubs to hang out and see a band. I think the club was called Haymakers. I was dancing, and I kept trying to do a front-to-back split until finally, there was a horrible pop. It was my left knee, and I couldn't walk on it. It was terrifying in that moment, being in excruciating pain off in the corner of a suburban rock club and unable to walk. I had to have one of my friends help me hobble along. For the next couple of days, I was barely able to limp around. When I went to the doctor, I found out that I needed to have immediate knee surgery. That's because a tiny bone fragment chipped off of my knee and had to be removed. I had the surgery at St. Margaret's Hospital in Hammond, Indiana, and everything was routine. My friends came up to see me and kept me company. Chicago's first punk fanzine, the Gabba Gabba Gazette, did a photo shoot and cover story about the whole thing. They kept me there for several days, and while I was in the hospital, I wrote I Need Something and She Lives for Love. By the time I actually turned 21, my band and I had already started to find our audience. That certainly included the troops from La Mer Vipere, who came out in full force that night. My fans gave me gifts, including a cake. Besides returning to the stage, I had a gift of my own to offer to the audience. I was introducing my brand new band member to the world, Karen Winter. Kicking off the festivities was my first cousin and radio DJ, Bobby Skafish, who introduced us. Let me first clarify a little something. Bobby got the date of my injury right, but incorrectly called it a performing injury. The first song was You Invited Me. It started with Greg Cerchet's growling bass line. That laid the foundation for the opening lyric of Such a Nice Birthday Party. There it was, the perfect party opener. The live version included on this recording and the studio version from my album What's This? 1976 through 1979 are compositionally similar. The lyrics and arrangements have a certain degree of contrast, yet the vibe is very much the same. On the bootleg recording, Larry Maslin's chorus co-lead vocal, along with my band's energy, helped make this track. I Need Something is a song that has never been released in any form before. Written shortly before this concert, my return to the stage performance was probably the only time we ever played it live. Currently, the live bootleg is the only recording I have of it. When composing it, I fused two seemingly diametrically opposed elements, which were punk energy combined with a more prog, progressive compositional style. The stream of consciousness lyrics reflected the kind of existential search for purpose that I felt at the time. Listening to it now, I enjoy the rhythmical steadiness of Myslivik's drumming. I also get into the carnivalesque ambience of the keyboard parts that David Prohaska and I played. Even though this song didn't continue to be in our repertoire, at least for me, my keyboard solo alone made it worthwhile for that one performance. Until I heard the live bootleg tapes in early 2009, I completely forgot about this first version of We'll See a Psychiatrist. It began being composed in 1975, was completed in 1976 and first performed that same year. As opposed to the version on my debut album, the lyrics on the bootleg track were more directly focused on the abuse from my mother in a stream of consciousness way. On my debut album version, the lyrics were much more direct, story-like, and morbidly resigned to my role in the experience. Musically, this version has a ghoulish heaviness about it. You can hear that in Karen Winter's adapted slide guitar work on the latter sections and the atonal free-for-all ending. On both versions, the lyrics, melodies, composition style, and arrangements were notably different from each other. I wrote 5 O'Clock Face in the 1974-1975 time period, and it was first performed live in 1976. This composition, which is experiencing its first release of any kind, was really about my mother losing my father when I was just 15. That was an unusual topic to write about at the time. That's because pop culture songs were primarily about the youth, not about what happened to people in middle age. To me, this piece is haunting and atmospheric, with the verses having a new age feel before that was a common musical genre. David Prochaska's combination of organ and electric piano were played so precisely that allowed my vocal to have the breathing room to freely express itself that it needed. What I personally cherish about this track is how the writing style was so structurally different than pop music. I didn't use a chorus or much melodic repetition to hook the listener in. Really, the piece progressed much like reading a storyline in a book. During the end section, Maslin's guitar and Winter's adapted slide guitar signified the foreboding sense of doom that my mother had to face. Her husband and life partner had died. Listening to it now, I appreciate how their dueling guitars express those dark and miserable emotions so explicitly. I have fun listening to this more stripped-down version of Joan Fan Club, which was written and first performed in 1976. That's because it has a raw, punky, Americana garage feel. To me, the way the band pounded out the finale section feels like someone being militarily tortured. At the very end of the piece, Prochaska's metronome-perfect repetitive organ line adds to the relentlessness of the message. As a composition, the bootleg version was similar to the one on my first album, except some of the lyrics were different. Both of these pieces graphically represented my personal experiences, yet they provided a template that speaks the message of a much deeper level of social commentary. Unfortunately, it foreshadowed the social abuse and bullying that is so common and perhaps even worse today. Back in 1975, I did an abstract, out-there performance art piece at the Art Institute of Chicago for a friend of mine who was a student there. With that spirit in mind, I wrote Sunstroke in 1976, the same year it started being performed. Before the bootleg, this piece has never been released in any incarnation at all. The plotline of the song was existential and absurdist. It was the story of an old, ethnic woman who was all alone in life, aimlessly raking, hoeing, and putting leaves in her bushel basket. That was the scenario I acted out exactly on stage. The music was so opposite of pop because this entire piece was built off of one repetitive idea, just like a tape loop. Prochaska's clockwork organ and my singing represented the meandering, seemingly pointless reality of this old ethnic woman. Lyrically, she's resigned to a life of function and nothingness. In deliberate contrast, Maslin's guitar and Winter's adapted slide guitar mimicked the sound of her raking, hoeing, and expressed her internal agony. Their guitar work was purposely in a completely different tonal and rhythmic universe than the other musical parts. That deliberate clash reminded me of someone scratching their nails on a chalkboard while plugged into a big Marshall amplifier stack. It often unnerved people, as it was artistically designed to. I conceived of my adapted slide guitar as the ultimate punk instrument. In part, that was because traditional harmonic rules were thrown out the window. Let me explain. I tune the 6 strings in nonlinear order to comprise the whole tone scale. If you don't know what that musically means, just imagine a combination of musical notes that makes you feel suspended, displaced, and floating. That's how the whole tone scale tends to affect the listener. When we added heavy loudness and distortion into the mix, it became the ultimate aggressive attack instrument. Karen Winter played that instrument superbly. The opening power chords of I Might Move In Next Door represented my call to action, which was to get revenge on society. In this piece, the only similarity between the version on my second album, Conversation, and the first version here was literally the title itself. This first version has a great interplay between Sarchet's bass playing and the contrast in guitar work of Larry Maslin and Karen Winter. Throughout my entire life, I have been treated like a complete outcast in the neighborhood I grew up in. So when I wrote I Might Move In Next Door, I thought to myself, write about it, externalize it, and throw it right back in people's faces. I really had hoped that I could capitalize on it all by getting even with the world that had treated me wrong. When I first started performing Start at the Start in 1976, I created a composition that musically represented one of my strongest desires. That was my passion to create brand new art forms and also to blend seemingly contradictory styles together. Because of how diverse and musically complex the piece ended up being, it's one of my favorites from that era. It incorporated so many styles that wouldn't be thought of as going together. The song had new wave, punk, garage, rock, and pop. It also featured prog, progressive jazz, atonality, polytonality, polyrhythm, march, and 20th century avant-garde. The lyric was autobiographical with a message of social commentary about those of us who were left out, made fun of, and just need a friend. Start at the Start was very different because it crossed so many styles. That confused people at the time because they just didn't know how to take it. Of course, I didn't attend my high school prom, and the reason was simple. No one was really interested in going with me. So since I didn't end up going, it emotionally hit me as a haunting afterthought after I graduated high school. That dream was over with. I think I saw my failure to get a date to the prom as a metaphor of so many lost dreams, innocence, having fun in school, being a part of things like the other kids, and dating. Since I was denied so many of those things, that sense of loss motivated me to do what I obsessively did, which was to write a song about it. And one of those was I Missed the Prom Last Night. First written and performed in 1976, it has never been released on any level before. In the piece, I wanted to sing about one of the many high school dreams that I had been denied from experiencing. Because the song was about a traditional teenage topic, I decided to musically build it on a classic teen pop foundation. Then, here was the Skafish twist. I did a role reversal by singing it from the female perspective. Up to that point, that had not been done too much at all, especially in that type of pop song. Even with the lyrical twists, I think of I Missed the Prom Last Night as a classic pop song. That's because it combines all of the traditional aspects of that type of writing. A strong melody, contrast between sections, a hooky chorus, and a unique bridge section. We'll see, the Chicago Cubs baseball game was originally written and performed in 1976. On the bootleg, it's also experiencing its first release. In one sense, the piece was lyrically and conceptually about my dad's death when I was just 15, and the perspective of what it was like for me to lose my father at such a vulnerable point in life. At the end of the song, I asked this question. Daddy, now that you're dead, is it too late for us to be friends? Huh? Even though that last line at first may have sounded comedic and absurd, it posed these very real questions. Does life continue after death? And if so, is it too late for my father and I to have a friendship? Will he watch over me in the afterlife? This piece was also about my father taking me to Chicago Cubs baseball games when I was a kid. FYI, he wasn't a White Sox fan. In the song, I wanted to capture how I felt so disconnected and out of place sitting in that cavernous, intimidating stadium. I tried to let the song capture how it felt for me to be riding down the Dan Ryan Expressway to get there and feeling nauseous in the car. That was one of the values I could offer as an artist, which was to honestly and nakedly portray my experiences that were not at all what most people typically went through. It was an ultimate statement of alienation. I doubt that anyone other than me felt the way that I did at those baseball games. From a broader perspective, the naked lyric talks about how so many sons have been denied a relationship with their father. As many of us know, that can be such a source of pain and longing. Musically, the frenzied yet precise musicianship of the band helped to ignite the track. That featured the rhythm section of Sarche and Myslovic, which was part of the Skafish signature sound. It really was punk meets classical discipline, which is something that has always been quite rare. The opening riff sounds mechanical, as if it might have been done by a machine. But it wasn't. Just like every note was on the bootleg, it was played live and in real time. No Liberation Here sounded the alarm on sexual liberation. Or as I said that night, anti-liberation. Because I knew then, and sadly, I still know now that people are not truly free. The composition, arrangement, and lyrics of the first version featured on the live bootleg are similar to the 1977 studio recording from What's This? In contrast, the recording on my debut album is not the same at all. It is much slower and darker. The lyrics are notably different, along with certain musical and melodic passages. To me, this live bootleg performance is the most emotionally raw of the three versions. It walks the tightrope between cathartic abandon and discipline. I love the dueling solo in the middle of the song between Larry Maslin and me. Because of its message, there was so much that could be said about this piece. It was originally composed in 1976 and first performed by us that year, and it is one of my personal favorites from that period. With all my heart, everything that I feel, I wish that it was lyrically outdated, but it's perhaps even more relevant today than ever. Still, I frequently see stories on the news about kids who were killed, bullied to death, or end up committing suicide for being gay. Even kids who are not actually gay end up getting killed or bullied to death for simply being perceived as being gay. Or it just happens because they're considered weird. I've experienced a lot of persecution and abuse throughout my life. That, along with my deep sense of compassion and empathy, causes me to get torn apart every single time I come across one of those stories. Sometimes, if I'm not emotionally prepared for it, just listening to No Liberation can, out of the blue, bring me to tears. Yet, those feelings aren't only sad. There is also a tremendous desire for justice and healing. The first version of Take It Out on You at least helped me to express the rage-based emotions that I was dealing with at that time. On both the first version included on the live bootleg and the one on my debut album, the song was about revenge. However, the actual lyrics themselves between the two versions were different. Each version had its own distinct melody line. The one on my debut album had the punch your lights out finale section. My motive for writing the piece was clear. I wanted to get even for all of the brutality that was heaped upon me daily. No, I didn't like it. Who would? And of course, I didn't deserve it. And yes, I wanted justice. So I wrote this very intense punk piece with a lot of emotional angst that I feel comes through so well on the live bootleg recording. Musically, the precision and intensity of the band gave this piece the wallop I intended it to have. My keyboard introduction and solo are similar to what I performed on my debut album. I poured a lot of the angry emotions I felt into Home Invader when I wrote it in 1976. The bootleg recording is the first time any version of the song has ever been released. The narrative is the story of the home invasion and heinous murder of a lily-white, upper-middle-class suburban family. The idyllic home and perfect family were the metaphors of society's values that mocked me, rejected me, tormented me, and ultimately discarded me. I found a terrific outlet in this kind of psycho-punk, doom-metal, sexual murder song. Expressing those emotions through art was the only way I knew how to deal with what I felt back then. Musically, Like Start at the Start, Home Invader was one of the most musically complex pieces on the bootleg. This piece foreshadowed some elements of the dark and doom-oriented metal movements that were to come in the future. The song started with heavy metal riffs, power chords, and my lead guitar work. That was followed by the horror show tonalities on the verses. After that, the listener might have been a bit surprised to hear a quasi-breezy, easy listening section. Then, the chorus slammed in. Karen Winter's adapted slide guitar playing in the last verse was profoundly disturbing. So was My Slivik's military-style snare drum work. It sounded like rounds of shots that were being fired at Mommy and Daddy. When the second instrumental section kicked in, it was a musical nightmare from hell. Yet it was so beautifully structured and disciplined, especially Prohaska's loony chromatic organ runs. What stands out about the lyrics is the dichotomy of how I taunt the family by engaging them in disingenuous questions. Like, how are you feeling? How are you doing? In the context of the song, I got off by watching them suffer. That was the metaphor of me destroying the abuse and rejection I had been continually subjected to. Just when the audience might have wondered how much more out there the music could have gotten, we went into Sink or Swim intro. I wrote it in 1976, and we started playing it that year. To me, Larry Maslin's stunning guitar playing on the introduction alone was enough to release the track. His performance combined experimental jazz and 20th century avant-garde with punk abandon. Larry really got what I was trying to say with this composition. Larry Myslivik's drumming displayed a level of raw power and virtuosity that was seldom seen in rock music. The lyrics on both the first album and the live bootleg weren't the same, but the message was similar. On my debut album, Larry Maslin's guitar intro ended up getting replaced by the synthesizer work of Javier Cruz. Even though this recording was not a full-length version, I made the decision to release it anyway, because I really felt that it was still worth hearing. I wrote Let's Play Doctor in 1976, and we performed it that same year. For my birthday show, it was a great song to begin our second set with because of its high-energy feel. The song explicitly represented psychosexual confusion. Of course, the lyrics were completely real, and so was the intensity. I just threw it all out there with lines like, "Slicer, dicer, they won't let me be like her. All I can do is slice and dice." Then, I concluded the piece with the lyric of, "Slice a pubis up," over a flurry of atonal notes. Musically, I'm pleased with the tightness of the band, especially my rhythm section of Sarche and Myslivik. Prohaska's organ solo stands out nicely to me in its unlikely combination of garage, atonality, and punk. And Karen Winter's power chords slashed through like surgical incisions. Waterhead Chant was composed and debuted live in 1976, and this is the first time it's ever been released in any form. On the bootleg, it's a 52-second spoken word piece. It's accompanied by music that transitions from aimlessly slow to fast two different times. Then, it ends with a brief finale section. Just like in Joan Fan Club, I took on the role of the persecutor, this time as someone quite prim and proper, who just didn't want those waterheads in their nice community. And of course, those freaks must be thrown out and discarded. This time, my intended social commentary was to shed light on the prudish gatekeepers of communities. They take it upon themselves to decide just who could stay, and who could not, who's okay, and who is not. The lyric of, "It must repent for all its sins," drew upon my Catholic guilt, which was always a favorite Skafish theme. Winter's deliciously nauseating adapted slide guitar really made this performance, in my opinion. With guitar feedback ringing, the band segued into Tattletale, which brought a sense of relief to the audience. You can hear it from their delightful shouts once the groove kicked in. Tattletale, along with We'll See a Psychiatrist, were both directly written about my life in the sixth grade. That's when the relentless abuse by students and teachers really hit a crisis point. On both the bootleg version and the studio recording on What's This, David Prohaska's backing vocals and organ became one single voice. It reminds me of a snotty schoolyard bully, and I love it. Overall, I enjoy the fun combination of new wave, rock, pop, and the classic Chicago blues lead guitar phrases by Larry Maslin on the bridge section. Both recordings were similar as compositions, except for some degree of variation in the lyrics, melody, and arrangement. The live bootleg version is a bit higher in energy and faster in tempo. As I offered a dedication to everyone from La Mer Repair, my band and I went into Maybe One Time. We were certainly performing many intensely disturbing pieces which appealed to one type of audience. On the complete opposite end of the spectrum, we had the musical reach to include a song like Maybe One Time in our repertoire. That could have attracted more pop-oriented listeners. A lilting song of romantic longing, the version from my first album, the recording on What's This, and the live bootleg track are all similar as compositions. The arrangements differ somewhat, and the lyrics only vary a bit. You might think that the song would have increased our commercial potential, but only made things more convoluted for us in the marketplace. Maybe One Time could have probably been a bona fide hit single at the time. That is, if I only looked like a 1970s pop star. Well, I never considered having the surgeries it would have taken to make that happen. I remained me, and the song has remained a favorite of my audience. Beefcake Touch, first written and performed in 1976, represented how genre-defying our musical and performance range was. An edgy and sexually controversial piece, the bootleg recording is the first time any version of it has ever been released. This song was historically quite important for us, because it was not only Chicago's first queer punk hardcore song, but it was one of the very first of these genres worldwide. I wanted to comment on the dark, narcissistic side of the male gay scene. In the song, there was nothing arty, hip, playful, or relationship-oriented about it. I handed the song off to Larry Maslin, in part because I believed he could sing it phenomenally, which he did. Plus, he wasn't in a woman's one-piece bathing suit with boobs, like me. Musically, the intro is one of my favorite moments on the record. That's because of the brutal triple guitar assault of Karen Winter, Maslin, and me. The tonalities, intensity, attitude, and techniques we displayed in that moment as a guitar trio were a rare treat to hear. Certainly, we weren't just banging on our guitar strings. It was a harmonic and improvisational combination of a lot of things. That included polytonality, atonality, progressive jazz, punk, feedback, and some noise thrown in for good measure. Once the band kicked in, you can hear the masculine riff that was the foundation of the song. I wanted that riff to be non-melodic in a traditional way. Lifelong Friends represented a surprising U-turn, because it didn't fit our audience's expectations. Another composition that had never been released on any level prior to being on the bootleg, I wrote it and performed it in 1976. Musically, the underplayed musical and vocal performance was completely opposite of the many controversial aspects of what we did. Lyrically, the piece was about a unique topic. It foreshadowed a social phenomenon that occurred decades later, as much of my work has. The song was about a bi-curious attraction between two female friends, how men played into that scenario, and the muddy aspect of those feelings. Larry Maslin's guitar solo and my keyboard solo hopefully emphasized the indie jazz vibe that underscored the piece. After introducing my band to the audience that night, we launched into the first cover song I've ever released. That's the amazing 1958 Bobby Darin smash hit, Splish Splash. On the bootleg, it's followed by two of my own pieces, Toilet Train and One Size Fits All. They were both written and initially performed in 1976. The performance of these three pieces showcased yet another side of our artistry. That was our ability to execute the innocent teenage fun of 1950s rock and roll with contemporary new wave. Splish Splash, like so many 1950s rock and roll masterpieces, transcends time, trends, and generations. I remember hearing that it was written very quickly, within a matter of minutes. We came out of Splish Splash with Prohaska's dominant execution of the opening organ riff to Toilet Train. This piece, which is experiencing its first release ever, referenced my dysfunctional childhood. I used the metaphor that the reason for my problems was because I was not toilet trained by my parents. I wrote lyrics that supported that premise. Hey, I even referenced Dr. Spock, a well-known pediatrician at the time, just for good measure. Then, drawing upon my heavy blues influence, I performed the intro keyboard passage to One Size Fits All. It's a classic rock and roll meets new wave kind of a piece that has never been available on record before. The message was about conformity and being stuck in society's suffocating box. Like anyone, I wanted to break out of that prison. When I issued the threat to all the weirdos, sissies, and fags in the audience of, "Do you want a knuckle sandwich?" Did I really mean it? The lyric to Knuckle Sandwich was vintage Skafish, dealing with sissy bashing, weirdo bashing, and gay bashing. Obviously, I was not the one who ever attacked anyone. That's not me. But just as I did with other Skafish pieces, I put myself in the role of the attacker to hopefully let the song really get the point of my social commentary across. I started writing Knuckle Sandwich in 1975, completed it in 1976, and the Skafish band first recorded and performed it in 1976. As a song, the live bootleg version is similar to the studio version that appeared on What's This. On the bootleg, the waltz section was extended and I did some spoken word ad-libbing during that part. Coming out of that deranged waltz section, my band changed musical speed and direction flawlessly. The live bootleg version sounds more forceful and aggressive, and less arty than the August 1976 studio version. When we closed the second set, we put together a finale that my band and I hoped would just blow the audience away. It started with Kissy Face and Bachelor Pad, and ended with Sign of the Cross. All three of these songs were written and first performed in 1976. Kissy Face and Bachelor Pad have never been released on any level before, well, Sign of the Cross has. Kissy Face was an interlude kind of a thing that featured David Prohaska's extremely well-executed sequencer-like organ intro. That was followed by a repetitive musical loop played by the band. That became the foundation of this existential piece that only lasted 2 minutes and 8 seconds. Plus, it didn't use conventional songwriting structure at all. The musical foundation was laid by Winter's disorienting adapted slide guitar. That set the stage for lyrics that spoke to meaningless romantic futility, revulsion and disconnection, and even referenced someone who shot himself dead because he went deep into debt. Sounds a little familiar in today's world 35 years later. With guitar feedback ringing, I belted the line, "I used to live with my parents!" And we went into Bachelor Pad. I wrote this piece from the perspective of a young guy who left home to get his own pad. I wanted the lyric to embody a sense of cool meets parody, and for the song to be a colloquial document of the time. Catchy rock riffs, cocky groove, and a combination of garage, punk, and classic rock, I wanted the last verse to kick the piece over the top. The deranged striptease music that came next could have prompted this audience question. Are the people playing this stuff mental patients out of some insane asylum? Yet, that music served quite a functional purpose, because it was music for me to strip by. Hey, but this was no normal striptease. I went down to the floor and stripped to an ugly, musty, old lady's old-fashioned one-piece bathing suit with babushka and applied lipstick to my face. Whenever I did this from 1976 to the end of 1977, early 1978, people tell me that it was literally one of the most shocking transformations ever witnessed in a rock stage show. That was because of its intensity, strangeness, and that it pushed virtually everyone's deepest psychological buttons. My stripping often provoked violent crowd reactions. Not only was it a statement of gender and sexual confusion, but like so much of what I've always done as an artist, it triggered and confronted people's deepest issues. I'm talking about gender identity, sexuality, sexual preference, men being masculine and women being feminine. Also, it shattered the existing image of the rock star by portraying something so deliberately unattractive, edgy, and uncomfortable. It was hard to pump one's fist in the air and identify with, and it often made the audience squirm with discomfort. For the strip section, my band drew upon one of the many skills that we musically possessed. That was to be able to go into spontaneous improvisation at any time and let the music evolve however we felt in that moment. So if you've ever heard the strip section from any other performance, it would never be the same. This was a statement of a lot of things, including jazz, progressive jazz, polytonality, atonality, and punk aggression. Certainly, that was a combination of musical disciplines and sensibilities that were quite rare. When I stumbled back on my feet in my one piece, I asked the utterly audacious question of, "Do you want to go to heaven?" Right there, I engaged another aspect of society's most volatile psychological minefields. That was God, Jesus, religion, eternity, and the afterlife. As most of you already know, Sign of the Cross became the first blatantly sacrilegious rock song ever when I wrote it in 1976. Musically and compositionally, the live bootleg version and the studio version on What's This are similar. Yet there are some differences. The order of the verses between the two versions is somewhat different. The studio track that was recorded in October of 1977 includes two verses of lyrics not present on the live bootleg. The most well-known version to date was recorded live in France in August of 1980 in front of approximately 20,000 people. That was for inclusion in the international concert film Erg, A Music War. On that version, the lyrics were more similar to the studio version, yet there was one less verse, and certain words were changed here and there. Also, the arrangement had some new elements to it, such as the pre-goth, pre-death metal Mellotron intro. The last chord of Sign of the Cross and the audience reaction was a milestone moment. Hearing it now, I can feel the effect the song had 35 years ago. As always back then, I performed the piece barefoot after I stripped, so when I left the stage, I cut my foot on some broken glass. It was bleeding profusely, but I just wanted to get back on stage to do the encores, and I did. Recently, a friend of mine who was at the show reminded me that the dressing room at Ratso's was in the basement. He recalled how he and another friend had to barricade the door because the audience was trying to barge their way in. It just sort of reminded me of how frenetic and exciting that time period was. This performance is a snapshot of that energy, that time period, and it captures an essence of the Skafish spirit from 1973 through 1977. Looking back now, I am tremendously grateful for the experience. I appreciate that my incredible band and manager, Scott Cameron, were there with me. I am glad that I decided to stay with this project and that 35 years later to the day, this one moment in time has come full circle. This record succinctly captures the Skafish experience, the edginess, the outrage, the musical innovation, the crossing of multiple genres, the creation of new ones, the musicianship, and the social commentary. If you were there in the trenches with me 35 years ago, I hope this is an exciting and fun reminder of what it was really like. If you're just discovering me now, I hope this record inspires you to want to learn even more. You're not a friend. All the years you thought you only wanted them. You're not a friend.